Jason, I'm really glad to see you again, and I'm interested in what you've been doing since I saw you. The last time I saw you, you were at the Smithsonian Institution in Washington, D.C., and you were climbing a totem pole. What's happening with you now, and where are you living? Are you still in Alaska?
Hi, yes. originally, at the time that we've met, I was from Ames, Alaska, and then I moved down to Juneau for a short period of time before I went to Washington, D.C. And there was difficulty in being able to get the type of material that I needed for the commissions that I was getting. And so what I did was I moved to or resided in Ketchikan, and I've made that my home because Ketchikan seems to have a lot more abundance of the type of wood that I do in my project.
What kind of wood is that?
Red cedar and yellow cedar and a lot of alder.
Are you doing just totem poles? Do you do a variety of different types of items that you send your clients?
One of the things that kind of bread and butter money was doing jewelry, and I've gotten into doing on an individual basis, so that a lot of the commission work people would ask if they could be able to have a special made or a special made bracelet, and I go ahead and make them. Sometimes I get 10 groups small little tiny jobs, but the things that I do are kind of seasonal. Like, for instance, I try to do a lot of the big projects in the summer months, and then during the winter, I get into the masks and stuff like this.
Can you talk about the larger projects? And are you talking about totem poles now?
I'm talking about totem poles, screens, big projects for corporations.
Nathan, what is your market? Is it Native Alaskan market? Is it non-Native people living in Alaska, or people outside Alaska? How does that go?
My type of market goes on an individual basis, and I think that a lot of the people that are into the curio type of art is sort of mass productive. And on the mass productive scale items, there are a lot of duplication. And so I try to keep it pretty much on an individual basis, at least my work, and so that I try to make it a one-of-a-kind type thing. So that way, any type of art should be a little bit more controversial than just something that is duplicated.
How did you get into carving? Was it something that you grew up with in your family, or something that you've begun to do in recent years?
I didn't have any desire at all to be an artist or a carver. I didn't realize that I had the talent. And I had big dreams of being a fisherman and being a commercial fisherman, and being very competitive with the rest of the fishermen. But in the winter months, I used to watch my sort of an uncle, a fellow by the name of Fred Lawrence, who did a lot of carving, small miniature totem poles. I went into the service, and after I got back, I still had the same goal in mind of being a fisherman. But a lot of the things that I used to watch, I used to take little corner splinters and make small fingerling-sized totem poles. And I didn't pay too much attention to it. And I ended up in a hospital for about 55 days. They were thinking I had tuberculosis. And I just had a real acute case of pneumonia, and also breathing copper paint from the bottom of a boat. And as it turned out, through occupational therapy, I filled up the showcase with a whole bunch of miniature totem poles because of being very impatient individual. When I also started to get into portrait work, and I did one from a black and white clipping, and it was quite interesting. I never realized that I could be able to do that much. And after I got out, I decided, well, I'm going to start doing portraits. And when I started doing portraits, I started doing them from a photograph, and I really didn't have no training in that area. But I did come up with a close likeness. And as it turned out, I ended up going to Santa Fe. I started working for a fellow by the name of Carl Heimel, Alaska Indian Parks Incorporated.
Oh, I remember that.
And I started learning quite a bit at the Institute of American Indian Arts.
You were a student there?
Yes, I was a student there. I was an exception there. Of course, I was pretty old by then. And then after getting back home, I ended up being an instructor for block printing and silk screening. And I began to understand a little bit more about the motif and the background, and started doing a little bit of study, but through a fellow by the name of Bill Holmes, who has done a lot of research in Northwest Coast Indian art, I was able to, I started doing the drawings and everything, but I couldn't quite put it together and couldn't quite understand it, you know, the drawings and everything, and the simple methods that were applied in Northwest Coast Indian art. So I started applying them, and I started doing a lot of design for Alaska Indian art, and not only as an instructor at Manpower Development Training Program, but and then from there, about 67, I moved out and started doing a lot of freelance work, and that was the time when I went to Washington, D.C., and I went to Seattle to do a poll. But right now, what I'm trying to do is trying to inspire a lot of the people to do, improve, or try to show them that the art in itself is still in existence, and that it could be applied with the same type of quality as the old items that are in the museum.
Well, certainly those people who are acquainted with the art of Native Alaskan people realize what a high level it reached at the time, or the situation it was in at the time of contact with us. You mentioned being an instructor. Are there a lot of people who are now carving in Alaska?
Yes, it's in Juneau and Sitka and Anchorage, I think there has been quite a deep interest in carving. The prices are starting to raise, just like the prices of food are starting to raise. People can't keep up with the market of good quality items, and I think that you can take the novelty type and you can take the good quality, and I think there must be at least about 7 or 8 good carvers that I know of.
Really good people who are these people the kinds of people who are very deeply into the significance of what they're carving? Are they just carving for their own interest? Are they carving repeatedly without looking deeply at the background of the art itself?
I think there are about 3 in Alaska that I know that are in especially the Northwest Coast area that do it in the very fine arts area.
Mm.
And those that are just doing it just to be doing carving. And Sometimes we have people that are not really talented or wasn't able to do all that much research in Northwest Coast Indian art. So they just do it on a sort of master-degree scale.
You mentioned Bill Holmes earlier. Is this the Bill Holmes who lives in the United States and has written some books on art?
That's right.
Now, tell me, is there another Bill Holmes who is in Canada? And is it a native person who's doing some carving just now?
Not that I know of. Not to my recollection.
I remember coming across a guy up in Montreal one time who was doing some beautiful jewelry. And heard him referred to by other Canadian people as the outstanding carver in Canada.
The only outstanding jewelry carver that I know of, who is a protege of Bill Reed. Bill Reed is...
That's the name that I'm thinking of.
Okay,
Bill Reed,
I'm sorry. Bill Reed is probably one of the best untouchable characters that I know of, that I've seen a lot of his work, and I would say that the protege of Bill Reed is starting to lose his eyesight a little bit, but a fellow by the name of Robert Davidson Jr., who is protege, and he's really a fine, exceptional silversmith.
Is there very much communication back and forth between people in Alaska and people in Canada who are doing similar kinds of artwork to that you're doing?
I think that we try to keep in touch, especially if we have the same common ground and the common interests at heart. And either keep in touch or find out what each other is doing. And it isn't a touch spying thing, but we just... We just like to see the better quality of items that have been produced.
What do you see? Just I'd like to ask you one last question. As the future, in the future, for carvers who are doing some of the kinds of things many of us consider monumental Indian artworks because of their size, and certainly because of their relationship to a very rich past, a very rich art tradition. What's the future going to be like, do you think? Will it just continue the way it is now?
I seem to think that each one of us, as artists, usually and generally have sort of dreams accumulated in our minds. We see the changes that take place within society and the buildings that have come up here and there, and we know that 1% of the money for any type of building in art and public places, if a person has a sculptor especially has a big goal in mind, that they could be able to think of things in that perspective, you know, that it's wide open. There are a lot of possibilities, and but then an artist has to be the type of person that gets down and works at it, and you have to submit a lot of designs, and you have to show good quality and workmanship, and this is one of the things that I see, that a person can be able to move ahead.
You know, I'm really interested that you mentioned that a person has to submit designs and you know, really get down into the whole thing. And it's one more question, if you will. Carter, to me, to reflect on the background of your people. My small understanding of that is that there was a whole community of artists among Southeast Alaska Native people in the old days who were perhaps attached to families, is that correct, or who were contracted with to provide certain types of art. Is that correct?
Yeah, generally in the olden days when they did any type of commission work, a lot of big potlatches were involved, and of course paying off bills, and just like today's society, I think that anything is done, it's usually done in a sort of a commemoration of that particular happening, and so they usually have a pretty good size doing that.
Are there still potlatches then?
Yes.
Works of art that are being created in concert with those potlatches?
Yeah, you don't see them as much because a lot of the old timers haven't been they value more of the older things, and there hasn't been all that much new things that were done, like the big totem poles, and I think they probably were done more in British Columbia than they are done in Alaska. Generally, what I'm into right now is probably just replacing a lot of, I'm trying to, you know, my hope starts to be able to replace a lot of the older items, have the older items put and preserved in museums and such things. But that's almost copying. That's almost,
I can see what you mean, but at the same time it would continue for people to enjoy those things that are from the past, while at the same time preserving those new things. Nathan, thank you so much for taking time to talk.
There's another thing too. You know, I've had my mom usually remark to me about me not saying too much about my mom and where I'm coming from. She has been getting to this place, and so I'd like to say that if this was to get any place, that I'd like my mom, Nancy Jackson, to be mentioned here.
Wonderful. Well, okay. I can't think of anything nice when it comes to
that. Yeah. She's always saying, maybe you feel the same, but usually in talks like this, people don't bring these things up,
Exactly.
Okay.
And that continuity is so important. Thanks, Nathan.